term very loosely, reading one through the Bible in a year. And I am very much a slacker at times. And so in my slack and in my laziness, whatever you want to call it, I'll just call it laziness. The Lord has used that. Listen, we know all things work together, right? All things. So as I was behind and I shifted my dates forward on my little app, and I shifted the dates forward again, I read half of the day's worth. I'm like, that's stuff out of three different books. I felt just fine. I bumped it a little bit more. It had me at the same scriptures for days and days and days. And I was like, I've really got to get past this first two chapters here. But I had been going through the Old Testament, and several times in the reading, and several times in the things, I will read and I'll catch myself asking myself questions on why would God do that? Why would he want this? And one of the things that really has stood out to me through Deuteronomy, Joshua, some of these books was, why did God always send them in and make them kill everybody? I mean, that sounded harsh to me. And so as I was going through and reading, and that's kind of where I was, like, all the way through all these books where they have went in and taken the land. You know, God would say, I'm sending you in, the children of Israel, I'm sending you in, you're going to take the land, kill all the people except the women and children, or kill all the people, period. And I was like, man, that is harsh. Like, you're killing, what did they do to you? You know?
Wouldn't even let them take the animals.
I know, nothing. They completely would wipe out this entire area to go in and conquer the territory. Well, in my slack and in my everyday reading the same thing or pulling it up to the same thing, I got to Judges. And I began to read. And I listened to it mostly through audio version. And I listened to it in the NLT, so it's easier to get to understand. And in my reading, I was listening to it one day in the car, and I was kind of like halfway listening, halfway not. You know, it's kind of one of those things where I was about halfway paying attention. But they said something, and it stopped me in my tracks, and I was like, ooh, wonder what that has to do. You ever hear these things, and you think, I know that God's going to show me something, I just wonder what that has to do with something. Why did that stand out to me? And as I was listening, I just began to think, and then as I began to pile this together, Brad said, hey, you're preaching Sunday night. I was like, okay, here I am. So I opened back up and was in my app the other day, and the Lord started showing me some stuff. And it's not a whole lot. We might be out of here before 5 o'clock, y'all, I don't know. But I want to just read to you some and just give you a little background. And really, for most of us that are in Wednesday night class and Kevin's class, we've been over so much of this and talking about the blessings. You know, we've talked so much about the blessing and God's promises for us and being in Deuteronomy and talked about all these things. But if you read on in Deuteronomy chapter 28, and I'm just going to start there. I'm going to jump around a lot, so you may not even be able to follow me. And I'm reading out of the Holman Christian Standard Bible, so it's going to sound a little bit different. But if you read on, and starting in Deuteronomy chapter 28, and this is funny because this is not where I was going whatsoever. The Lord's doing something here. Moses begins to talk and tell the people what the Lord is saying. And the Lord starts out just hit and miss here. Now, if you faithfully obey the Lord your God, and you are faithful to follow all his commands I'm giving you today, the Lord your God will put you far above all the nations of the earth. And we love that part. We love the part in Deuteronomy where it says, you'll be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. We love to hang on to that. And we claim that, and we do. But if you go on down and you get to verse 15 of Deuteronomy chapter 28, he starts out by saying, but if you do not obey the Lord your God by carefully following all his commands and statutes that I'm giving you today, all these curses will come and overtake you. And I begin to think about our country. And we look at the country, we look at the state of everything is in, and we think, what in the world is going on? Why is it? We talk a lot about the sickness and the fact that people in the summertime are getting the flu, and they have all this stuff, like sickness never seems to end anymore. And how it seems like there's things that, you know, as we get closer to the end times, that we're seeing this more and more. But when you go on and you start to read just this little bit, he's warning the children of Israel right here. Do this and you're blessed. Do this and this is what's going to happen. Just like we give our kids the ultimatums. If you do this, we'll get a toy. If you don't do this, you're getting a whipping. Right? That's exactly what he's doing here with the children of Israel. And he tells them, he says, if you do not obey the Lord your God by carefully following all his commands and statutes that I'm giving you today, all these curses will come and overtake you. And this is just a little bit of what the Lord tells them. He says, you will be cursed in the city and cursed in the country. Your basket and your kneading bowl will be cursed. Your descendants will be cursed. And your land's produce, the young of your herds and the newborn of your flocks, you will be cursed when you come in and cursed when you go out. The Lord will send against you curses, confusion, and rebuke in everything you do until you are destroyed and quickly perish because of the wickedness of your actions and abandoning me. The Lord will make pestilence cling to you until he has exterminated you from the land that you are entering to possess. The Lord will afflict you with wasting disease, fever, inflammation, burning heat, drought, blight, and mildew. They will pursue you until you perish. And he goes on, and he talks about tumors and all these curses, all this stuff. You need to go through it, and I'll let you read it yourself. And it goes through all this stuff. And all these children of Israel have watched for years. They have went through the desert. They have been out of Egypt. They have been around the mountain. They have done all this stuff. And they have been faithful and then unfaithful. And faithful and unfaithful. And faithful and unfaithful. Just like we always are, right? We're always that way. And so it goes on, and they come out, you know, Deuteronomy. Moses gives their last warnings here. He gives the last messages of what God's telling the children of Israel, and he gets them ready for Joshua to take over. And we get into Joshua, and Joshua, you know, he brings the people into Jericho. They go around the walls. They go and take the city. And they've seen thing after thing after thing, victory after victory after victory that the Lord has brought them through. And what did God tell them, even in Deuteronomy, like we talked in class, how he charges them to share the word, to give the word to their children, to write it on their hearts, to put these things inside of them, to teach them. And so they have went through, kind of skipping over here, they went through with Joshua. And they went in and they started conquering the different towns, the different regions. They went in to fight. And you get to Joshua 10, verse 28 is where I'm going to start reading, just a little bit here. Still with the children of Israel, still with the generation that has been in the wilderness, the ones that have been born in the wilderness. Remember, all the ones that was already there had to die off before.
Yep.
They could go through. So these are the ones who were born in the wilderness, the ones who were right there and who God was telling them, teach your children, knowing that they weren't going to be there when they got to the next place. They had to teach their children the statutes and the things right there in that wilderness time is what he kept commanding them, because there was going to be a season where they were going to be the ones that had to fight and mommy and daddy weren't going to be there with them. That generation had to perish. So getting to Joshua chapter 10, verse 28, I'm just going to read a little bit. It says, on that day, Joshua captured Makeda and struck it down with a sword, including its king. He completely destroyed it on everyone in it, leaving no survivors. So he treated the king of Makeda as he had the king of Jericho. Joshua and all Israel with him crossed from Makeda into Libna and fought against Libna. The Lord also handed it and its king over to Israel. He struck it down, putting everyone in it to the sword, and left no survivors in it. He treated Libna's king as he had the king of Jericho. And he goes on, section after section after section, telling you all the places that they went into, and how Joshua and the Israelites went in, and how they took every one of these regions. And every one of them, you go through, and it says he struck them down, putting everyone in it to the sword, just as he did the one before. And you go through and you look and you see, and they get through Joshua, and you get a little on into Joshua, and they're still fighting these people. They're still going in and they're fighting all of these territories. They're wanting to take all these places. And it gets to the end of the book of Joshua, and Joshua dies. He's 110. And he dies. He's gone. And so 110 years of these ones, and they're saying, okay, you're supposed to be teaching your children. You're supposed to be raising up a generation. You're supposed to be one of these ones. And we get to Judges chapter 1. And here I am stuck on Judges chapter 1 for days, y'all, maybe a couple weeks. I'm so far behind where I really should be on my Bible stuff because I'm just halfway read it. But I was stuck and I kept shifting my days forward and shifting them forward. And finally the other day, I listened to Judges chapter 1. And I'm really, I'm probably supposed to be halfway through Judges by now, but I'm still on chapter 1 and 2 because I just can't get past it quite yet. But starting in Judges chapter 1, it says, after the death of Joshua, the Israelites inquired of the Lord, who will be the first to fight for us against the Canaanites? And the Lord answered, Judah is to go. I have handed the land over to him. And it goes down and tells you where Judah and he takes his brother Simeon, and they go out and they fight. Verse 17 says, Judah went with his brother Simeon, struck the Canaanites who were living in Zephah, and completely destroyed the town. So they named the town Hormah. Judah captured Gaza and its territory, Ashkelon and its territory, and Ekron and its territory. The Lord was with Judah and enabled him to take possession of the hill country, but they could not drive out the people who were living in the valley because the people had iron chariots. So Judah gave Hebron to Caleb, just as Moses had promised, and Caleb drove out the three sons of Anak who lived there. At the same time, the Benjaminites did not drive out the Jebusites who were living in Jerusalem. And you go on down, it says the house of Joseph also attacked Bethel, and the Lord was with them. They sent spies to Bethel, and the town was formerly named Luz. The spies saw a man coming out of the town and said to him, please show us how to get into the town, and we will treat you well. When he showed them the way of the town, they put the town to the sword, but released the man and his entire family. And they go to the next thing. It says, at that time, Manasseh failed to take possession of Beth Shean and its villages. And the more you read, every single tribe, every single one would go in. No, all the ones before them went in, killed them all, cleared out the town, took their territory. They all start going in, and it's starting, I'm starting to listen, I'm like, they're not taking what they're supposed to be taking. They've watched for years and watched as they went out into all these places and watched to see what happened when they were told when the Lord would send them, they were to go in, wipe out the area, and to go in. And they start, you know, if you're reading through it, start saying, well, they couldn't get them because they overpowered them, like the ones on the iron chariots. Talking about in Manasseh, it says that the Canaanites refused to leave the land. Why would they even give them the chance? Why was there not the attack? Why were they so subtle and coming back? Why were they not done? They refused to leave the land. So when Israel became stronger, they made the Canaanites serve as forced laborers. One version says they made them serve as slaves, but they never drove them completely out. At the time, Ephraim failed to drive out the Canaanites who were living in Gezer, and the Canaanites who lived among them in Gezer. Zebulun failed to drive out the residents of Kitron or the residents of Nahal. So the Canaanites lived among them and served as forced labor. So they would go in, and they could not run these people out. They could not get into the place and get the territory that they were supposed to be going into attacking. And so I'm reading and it started to click on me, what? Not one of them, not one of them has been able to go in and successfully take the territory that's supposed to be theirs. Not one of them has been in there. So I get to chapter 2 in my reading. It says, the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochan and said, I brought you out of Egypt and led you into the land I had promised to your fathers. I also said, I will never break my covenant with you. You are not to make a covenant with the people who are living in this land, and you are to tear down their altars, but you have not obeyed me. What is this you have done? Therefore, I now say, I will not drive out these people before you. They will be thorns in your sides, and when the gods and their gods will be a trap for you. When the angel of the Lord had spoken these words to all the Israelites, the people wept loudly. So they named the place Bochan and offered sacrifices to the Lord. Joshua sent the people away, and the Israelites went to take possession of the land, each to his own inheritance. The people worshiped the Lord throughout Joshua's lifetime and during their lifetimes of the elders who outlived Joshua. They had seen all the Lord's great works he had done for Israel. Since Joshua, the son of Nun, a servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110, they buried him in the territory of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the Mount Gash. The whole generation was also gathered to their ancestors. After them, another generation rose up who did not know the Lord or his works that he had done for Israel. A whole generation rose up after this, after they had been commanded, teach your children, write the word on your heart, put these things there. And I love, which I didn't bring my iPad, I was reading earlier, you have a whole generation that didn't know, listen, that didn't know the works he had done for Israel. And the first thing that I thought of was, what do we teach our kids? What are we telling them? What are we showing them? What are we letting them see? We say it over and over and over. We teach it over and over and over. But what are we teaching them? What are they seeing? You had generation after generation. They were in that wilderness for 40 years together. They had seen the pillar of smoke. They had seen the clouds. They had seen all of this stuff. They had seen the works. They had seen the manna. They had seen the quail. They had seen the water that had come from the rock. They had been there when the sea had parted. They knew all these things, but yet a whole generation came up later who knew nothing about the works that God had done for Israel, because suddenly everybody had shut up and everybody had forgotten because a whole generation had raised up. And if you go down on verse 11 in chapter 2, says, the Israelites did what was evil in the Lord's sight. Forgetting just a couple books ago, the Lord said, if you don't follow me, these are your curses. These are your options. You get the blessings if you follow, you get the curses if you don't. So it says, the Israelites did what was evil in the Lord's sight, and they worshiped the Baals and abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of Egypt. They went after other gods from the surrounding people and bowed down to them. They infuriated the Lord, for they abandoned him and worshiped Baal. It says, the Lord's anger burned against Israel, and he handed them over to marauders who raided them. He sold them to the enemies around them so that they could no longer resist their enemies. Whenever the Israelites went out, the Lord was against them and brought disaster on them, just as he had promised and sworn to them. So they suffered greatly. And here we have all of this, and I begin to look at what the Lord was showing me and what was a little bit deeper. And I begin to think about, you know, I was like, okay, God, what are you showing me? What do you want us to know? What was the reasons that he was saying, drive them all out? Drive them all out. In one place, he even says, drive them out and destroy their altars. Tear their altars down. Because they went in those foreign places, and when they didn't destroy them, they became subject to their gods. They became subject to the temptation there. And The first thing the Lord began to show me through all of this was how to overcome the enemy in our lives. Whatever the enemy is, whatever the fight is that we face, whether it's ones that have, you know, addiction, whether it's ones that are struggling with unforgiveness, it can be anything. Whatever it is that we face, whatever it is that we need to get rid of in us, whatever it is that the Lord says, this is the problem area for you, this is the area that you should be victorious in, this is the area that you have to drive out everything for you to get the show of victory. We all have those places. Listen, we all do. It's because we're fleshy people. And so we always have something that we've got to fight against. And I shared this on Facebook the other day. I saw this as I was reading. I have this new Bible. I haven't used it a whole lot. But I want to read this to you, and I'm going to give you my 4 points. And then we may make our eggs in here in a little bit. I don't have a whole lot more. It says, this is just a little note here. It says, the believer's obedience. It says, God commanded the Israelites to drive the Canaanites from the land and to possess it for themselves, according to his promise to Abraham. However, they did not follow the word of the Lord and thus failed their first test after the death of Joshua. Y'all ever feel like you're at that place where you've been with mom and dad, spiritual pastor, the spiritual leader that's serving, the ones that you've come up and you've learned under, and the ones you felt secure under, and then suddenly they're gone and you have to kind of like face something on your own? Just the Lord said, okay, let's see how you do with this one. And then we totally tank it. Okay, and so here we are, the reflection of the children of Israel here says, they failed their first test after the death of Joshua. Israel failed to obey the Lord completely, primarily due to spiritual apathy. The people had little spiritual hunger or motivation for the things of God, which translated into disobedience. As the prophet Samuel said to the disobedient King Saul, to obey is better than sacrifice. According to scripture, partial obedience is disobedience. Failure to follow through in obedience to God's commands results in spiritual failure. The Holy Spirit residing within believers empowers them to follow Christ fully. His Spirit is at work in you, enabling you to both desire and to work out his good purpose. If you've been crucified with Christ, Jesus' record of perfect obedience has been credited to your account. Sin's power has been broken in your life, and you are free to obey out of love for and devotion to God. Spiritual apathy. They didn't want anything to do with it. They wasn't interested in what God had done. They wasn't interested in learning. They wasn't interested in hearing. You know, if you're hungry enough for something, you're going to, I mean, let's all face it, which, you know, all these kids in here, and we're the same way. When our parents are saying something, and we were little, we were like, edge a little bit closer. Y'all know our kids all do. They want to hear. It's like they have ears throughout the house. Like you're saying something, they're like, what are they saying? What are they talking? I can hear you. What are you talking about? Who is doing whatever? And they only, because they're so nosy. They want to know so bad. How does that come? Because she's so right. She knows that she's the same way. But they do it. Like, they want to hear. They're right there. And they're hungry to know what's going on. They want to hear what mom and dad have to say. They want to know what happened to so-and-so because so-and-so might have to. And yet, we are so the same way. And that's what we should be doing spiritually. That's what we should be doing with the Lord. We should be so hungry to hear. We should be so hungry to know, like, those ribs and stuff this morning. There should be something that sparks a hunger in us to learn and to hear. And to not only keep it for us, but to take our kids and show them to work and to do. I was listening to TV Jakes yesterday, and he was talking about how, you know, the generation has passed. He said our fathers would sit around the table and would talk about the things of God. And he said we would do the dishes or whatever we could to hear what they were saying. And yet, we don't do that. We don't do it with one another, nevertheless do it with our kids. We're always kind of like busy, and we're always kind of like, because everything we do now is through a text message. I mean, it's the generation that we're in, but when everything's done through a text message, it's you and whoever's in that little bubble. And so nobody else hears. The rest of the world's not here. And so I loved even this morning when Brad was saying to you, take this out there. Take this money out there. Do something. Go put the Savior out there. Go teach whatever. Go share some Jesus with her. Get the word out. Let people know what's going on so that we can fuel that hunger. That absolutely is just, I mean, serious conviction whenever I'm reading this, and they, you know, they fail to obey the Lord completely due to spiritual apathy. God forgive us, because a lot of times we are at a place where we are just, whatever, you know, whatever, it's whatever, we're just not tired today, whatever, I've got tomorrow, whatever. I don't have to really be there. I don't have to really show up. I don't have to really read. I mean, like, I read 3 chapters yesterday. I really don't have to read the next 3 days or whatever. I don't really have to serve or be a part of this. And yet we may find ourselves in those places where we need to go in and defeat the enemy, or we need to go in and defeat depression, or we need to go in and defeat discouragement, or we need to go in and defeat the temptation. Because it's exactly what happened, is they went into these places where they didn't defeat the ones that they were set out before them. And the temptation was there. God said, okay, you're not there. The temptation's right there. You're going to be subject to their gods. You're going to be subject to that. And you've got to see if you're strong enough to withstand it. And so, 4 things of how to overcome the enemy in our lives. You notice in the one place I was talking about Judah. And they said that Judah was the one who was supposed to go out, because so they prayed and asked the Lord, who's supposed to go out first? Who's supposed to be out there? So we have to pray and ask the Lord for strategy and how to pursue whatever it is that we're facing, whatever it is that we are coming up against. It is our job to know the strategy of how to pursue our enemies. Number 2, once the Lord tells you what to do, do it. When he says to do it, and how he says to do it. Do it when he says, and how he says, because the Lord is always very specific. He's always very specific. We are very general because we like to hear things the way we want to hear it. Okay, God, you want me to pursue that? Great. Okay, but when God says, give this up, don't talk to this person, don't watch this show, don't spend your money there, don't. He always comes with a don't. I mean, it's everywhere. Do this, but don't do whatever. And so that's the thing. We have to do what he tells us to do, when and how. Because he will give us the strategy for those things. Number 3. Did you say hang on, hang on? Write faster. I've seen your hang on. Are you ready? Number 3. Fight the enemy completely until you have destroyed them in their territory. When that started in Judges, and like, I'm sure I have read bits and pieces of Judges, but I've never started at the beginning and read through. And when that started reading to me, and they started saying, Judah went out, but they didn't conquer. They didn't destroy the people. They became their slaves, you know. The others became their slaves, but they didn't destroy them. Then the next one went out, and they didn't destroy the people. And the next one went out, and they didn't destroy the people. And eventually, they became, you know, the Canaanites became their slaves, but eventually they became slaves to the Canaanites because they were tempted by their gods. And they married their children. They went in, and they subjected themselves not only to having that in their area, but they intertwined themselves with it. They made it part of their lifestyle. They made it part of their family. They coddled it and said, oh, we love you. We're accepting of our children. They wanted to marry the Canaanites. My daughter just loves him. So they just accepted it. And it destroyed them. They became subject to all of that. The last one, number four, is give God the glory and teach your children of his faithfulness and works, so that when you're gone, they'll follow him as well. We fight against so much. We battle against so much in our lives, in our churches, in our families, in our area. We wonder why we can't see victory in areas of our lives. For one, we're trying to do it on our own. We're trying to figure out our strategy, our way, because it's the easier way. You know, we've got that 3-minute prayer, oh God, take this from me, I don't want to do it anymore. Like I do every morning when I get up saying, today's going to be a better day, I'm going to eat right, I'm going to do better, Lord. I need your help, I can't do it on my own. And I do really good until about 12 o'clock, and I'm like, but I really need a s'more. I really need whatever. Like, Kate and I went out to dinner the other day, and we did so good, I still not eaten that cupcake, it was still there. They gave us a cupcake. I didn't eat the bread that was on the table. I ordered steak and vegetables because I was going to be so good. We're on a cruise in 40-some days. And I was like, I'm going to do good. And I had an excellent Friday. And I was like, thank you, Lord. I really felt like I had done something. And then Saturday I got up and I was like, okay, I'm going to make bacon. I have any bacon. Josh and Blake want waffles, so I make them waffles. And I was like, well, if I eat half a waffle, I'll just eat half a waffle this morning. And then I'll do well at lunch. And for lunch, I had, this is like confession of good food, so for lunch, I had tater tots and a chili cheese cone, foot long from Sonic, okay? And then we shopped forever in one store, that's our life. And we were hungry, so I had a smoothie out of the Ferrero milkshake machine and a half a bag of Fritos. And I was like, well, at least I can do good for supper. I will redeem myself. And we ordered pizza, and I got pizza and garlic breadsticks and breaded chicken stuff and cinnamon twist and ate every last bit of it. And I was like, Lord, what happened? We were just going to eat bacon for breakfast and start here. Because we don't completely die out. We don't completely fight against the enemy in our lives. And right now, the enemy in my life is carbs. I mean, we all face our own things. Mine is the fact that I can't get my flesh under control enough to say, no, thank you. I don't need 4 pieces of pizza and 3 of the chicken bites and 3 of the bread knots and a cinnamon thing. Oh, and whatever. It was thin crust pizza. Okay, so it was the most scorched about my response. Okay. It doesn't sound as bad that way. A little bread bites, okay. One plate, lots of itty bitty little pieces of carbs. But that's my flesh that I'm fighting right now. My flesh and my desires to do what I want to do, even though I know it's not healthy for me, it's not good for me, it controls me. Whatever controls you is what you need to drive out. It can be something little, it can be something big, it can be something from your past that you don't want to let go of, it can be the fact that you eat 4 pieces of cheesecake instead of 1 piece of cheesecake. Whatever it is, and I'm not bashing you. If y'all want to eat 4 pieces, I will sit down and eat the other 4 with you, okay? I'm not bashing you. It's whatever you need in your life. Let's go back to the state, y'all. I'm good with that. But we have to drive out the enemy completely. We're not seeing victory in our churches because we don't have altar services anymore where people stay and pray until they pray through. Where they get down on their knees and they cry and they sweat and they slobber and they hit the altar and they stay there until they know that something has changed. Because in the old days, you want to talk about the old days and why the old church saw so much more going on or why they were so much more spiritual or whatever, because they did not stop until they knew something had changed. They pressed in. They had all-night prayer meetings. They did what it took to see the victory. You know, I grew up where they would say, have you got the victory? No. Then we're praying again. And we don't fight that way anymore. We don't do that. We are a lazy, apathetic group of Christians worldwide who are so easy to say, oh God, please take care of this and do it. But I really need to go because I've got this next appointment. I've got this next meeting. I really don't have time to do this. I really don't want to fight because I don't want what you're asking of me. But we want the results and the consequences and the heart change of everybody else so that we feel better about it.
Right.
And so my challenge to you is just to look and, you know, maybe go in and read those first few chapters of Judges. Those last things right there, and just see what the Lord wants to do, because that's where we're at. Is He's saying, listen, we're at a close place, and I really believe that this weekend coming up, guys, please fast.